Hey everyone, this is Russell here with Gaming Nexus, or NeoCyther, depending on what channel you happen to be watching this on. And I'm here with another entry into Gaming Nexus Unplugged. So if you remember a while back, I did a couple of videos on Ascension, initially starting off with a couple expansions that I got from Ultra Pro that they asked me to review. And then I just kind of went back and did a video on how to actually play Ascension, covered a couple other sets, and well, here we are. So, a couple weeks ago, I got home from work and noticed there was a box on my front porch, and I was initially a little confused because I didn't remember ordering anything. And then I saw it's from Ultra Pro. And so my thought was, okay, maybe they actually sent me another Ascension expansion to review. Which is also weird because they never contacted me about that like they normally do. So, I got the box, came upstairs, opened it up, and to my surprise, I found this. A copy of the new Shards of Infinity deck building game, which, don't get me wrong, this is a very pleasant surprise to find. I just wasn't expecting it. And there was a note inside saying that they provided it to me for review. Again, the initial shock was the fact that I wasn't contacted first, but I'm always up for checking out a new deck building game, so I have no problems with that. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and talk about what actually comes with the game, and just kind of show the different cards, and then quickly go through how it plays and just kind of give my thoughts on it. So this isn't going to necessarily be, if you've followed any of my card game videos on my main channel, I normally just break this up into multiple segments. I'm not really going to do that here for this because I don't want the video to go on forever. So I'm just going to go and just briefly go through the different card types and then just show how the game itself works. So this is essentially everything you get inside the box. You get the rulebook itself, you have four player characters, which is something unique that I've seen to deck building games. There might be others out there that have character, I guess, cards or things like this. But this is the first one I have personally played that has something like this. And all the characters are essentially the same. They have the same ability at the bottom. They all track two different resources, I guess, for lack of a better term. The top will be a life counter that goes up to 50. The bottom is a mastery counter that goes from 0 to 30. I will talk about mastery here in a bit. And they all have, again, the same ability, which I'll also talk about that. And you also get 128 cards. 88 of them will make up your center row, or your center row deck. The other 40 are the four 10-player starter decks. This game will actually be played between 2 to 4 players. And I'll say this right now, that's not a bad thing, don't get me wrong. I will talk a little more about that here in a bit. So, I'm going to briefly, first before I go over the different cards, I'm going to go over the four different resources. So, before I get into that though, I will say this, if you have played, well, almost any deck building game, but specifically if you've played Ascension, then you already kind of have an idea of how this is going to work, which makes sense. They're both made by Ultra Pro. If you've also played a deck-building game called Star Realms, then the majority of this is going to sound really familiar, because a lot of things from those two games are both involved in this. So that kind of gives you a head start right there. So I'm going to discuss the first two resources that I've already mentioned first here. The first is your health. Now, if you remember my Ascension videos, the main goal was to gain honor by defeating monsters in the center row. In Shards of Infinity, however, you're actually using power to attack your opponents, and the goal is to knock everyone out by getting them down to 0 health. Or in this case, well, 0 is represented by a skull, meaning, well, you're dead. And the goal is just to be the last person standing. Now, it's worth noting that everyone will start the game at 50 health, but you cannot gain more than that. There are ways to gain health throughout the game, but you can never go more than 50. So once you hit 0, you're out. The next thing to note is down at the bottom, you have a little meter for mastery, which is a little yellow star, for lack of a better term. I'm sure there's something that could be called, and I'm just not thinking of it. What that represents is there are certain cards that will have mastery levels, just kind of find one here. Actually, at least one of your starter cards has mastery levels, but I want to save that because there's something really important on one of those cards later. So, for instance, Fungal Hermit here. When you play him from your hand, you would normally gain one mastery. But you'll notice down here, there is a little line that has a number 10 inside that little star, and it has an effect next to it. That represents what mastery level you need to be at for that ability to kick in. So, throughout the game, everyone starts off with a set number of mastery, and throughout the game, you'll be able to gain more of it up to a max of 30. And if, for instance, in this case, I were to play Fungal Hermit, and I had at least 10 mastery, I would then gain 5 health. If I didn't have at least 10 mastery, that effect would not go off. In terms of ruling, just to get this out of the way, if you play a card that says you gain mastery, and that would put you at the mastery level on that card, you still get that effect. So if I played this starting at 9 mastery, I would gain the one putting me at 10, and then I would get the 5 health for having 10 mastery. Just to clear that up right away. But that's essentially what mastery is. When you play a card that has an effect for having a certain mastery level, you don't actually spend the mastery. So it's not like I use that ability and I knock myself back down to 0. Mastery is permanent. I don't even believe there are any cards to reduce your mastery. So, obviously mastery is something you want to kind of keep track of during the game, because the more of it you get, the more powerful a lot of your cards become, including one that you actually start the game with. And again, I'll get back to that in a bit. The other two resources are resources that, again, if you're familiar with my Ascension videos, or if you played Ascension, then they are pretty much self-explanatory. This works better. The first one are gems. Gems are basically your currency. They're what lets you buy things from the center row. And that's as simple as that. The other is power. It's going to be a little hard to see on this card, but it is the number represented in the red circle. And that is used to attack your opponent, or another type of card called champion, which I'll get into here in just a moment. But those are the four main mechanics. Again, if you've played Ascension, power and gems are essentially like the power in runes from Ascension. Health is self-explanatory. It's your character's health. And then mastery is basically the only really new thing, so to speak, if you've played the other games or played other deck building games. And it's just the more mastery you get, the more powerful some of your cards become. So to go through the 10 starting cards real quick, everyone starts out with the same 10 cards, which will consist of 7 crystals, which will each give you 1 gem each. You have a blaster to give you 1 power. You have a shard reactor, which by default, you will gain 2 gems when you play it. But no, also it has 2 mastery levels at 5 and 15 that will give you certain increases in gems instead. A lot of the mastery effects, they don't necessarily stack. You just get what's next to the mastery number instead. So if I played a shard reactor when I have mastery of at least 5, I don't gain 5 gems. I just gain 3 due to the mastery level down there. And the final card, the big one I was mentioning earlier, is Infinity Shard, which is one that gives you 2 power, kind of like Shard Reactor in a way. Except this gives you 2 power, and it has 3 mastery levels. Now, the reason why I wanted to save this until now is because take a look at that last line. I mentioned that you can go up to 30 mastery, and that's not necessarily a requirement to win the game. But if you hit 30 mastery, you've essentially won the game, because you gain infinite power. And remember, the goal is to pretty much wipe all your opponents down to 0. And infinite power will pretty much help you do that. So, now that we've gone ahead and taken a look at the different mechanics, your starting cards, I'm going to go ahead and flip through a few of the different card types real quick. So, there are 3 major card types you can purchase from the center row. Make sure I'm not completely forgetting anything. The first is, well, technically there's 2, but one of them has like a subtype, so to speak. So the first one is Ally. Allies are put into your discard pile when you pay for them using gems. Sorry, I keep moving this around. I got my viewfinder on my camcorder upside down for some reason. I'm trying to get this. There we go. I'm trying to get this a little more centered. So, you'll purchase these from the center row, and then they go into your discard pile. And then, when they come into your hand during your turn, you can play them and gain any effects they have. A subtype of allies are mercenary allies. These are noted by having the word mercenary above the card type, and the gem cost is also in red. Now, these can be recruited like a typical ally, put into your discard pile and so on, or you can fast play these. When you fast play mercenary, when you pay its gem cost, instead of putting it in your discard pile, it immediately goes into play and you immediately gain its effects. Now, while you can fast play multiple mercenaries per turn, you can only fast play a particular mercenary once a turn. So, for instance, Le Shiny Knight, for a cost of 3, just ignoring the Unify ability real quick, says I gain 3 power. Now, that doesn't mean I can fast play this twice for 6 gems and gain 6 power. But there is a catch to fast playing a mercenary. When you fast play a mercenary, at the end of your turn, any mercenaries you fast played don't go into your discard pile, but they go on the bottom of the center deck, or the center row deck. So, fast played mercenaries, you do not put them in your discard pile, and you can't recruit them after you fast played them. So I can't, for instance, pay 3 gems to fast play Le Shy Knight, and then before my turn is over, pay 3 more gems and recruit him. So you can either recruit a mercenary, or you can fast play it, but you can't do both. And the third type of card is Champion. Now, if you're familiar, again, with Ascension, these are essentially like constructs. When you play a champion, they will go into play, they stay in play from turn to turn until something else gets rid of them. But unlike constructs from Ascension, champions also have a health value. So they will stay in play until a card effect discards it or an opponent deals damage enough to it to get rid of it. Now, I'll talk more about dealing damage when we get into how the game is played here in just a moment. But when you deal damage to a champion, you have to deal all the damage at once to get rid of it. Champions do not keep track of damage between turns. So if my opponent only if I had, for instance, Evocatus here in play, and my opponent only had 1 power left to do something with, he couldn't deal the 1 to Evocatus, and then that 1 damage sticks. It's either he has to deal 2 damage to get rid of it, or he can't do anything to it at all. So that takes care of the different card types. So I'm going to go ahead and get a game set up, just to kind of show how a couple turns would flow. So when you're ready to begin playing, the first thing you do is you go ahead and grab your character. Again, it's basically all aesthetics because all characters do the exact same thing. And then go ahead and decide who goes first. Now, when you decide who goes first, obviously you have your person who's going first, and in play just kind of goes clockwise like every other game or most games. But your starting mastery is determined by the order you go in. So both players start off with 50 life, but the first person the person taking their first turn first, I can't talk today, will set their mastery to 0. Then the person who will be going next sets their mastery to 1. And if you're playing a 3-player game, the third person will set their mastery to 2. And in a 4-player game, the fourth person will set their mastery to 3. So, for the purpose of this demonstration, Decima will be going first. They'll have their mastery set to 0. And Volos will go second and set their mastery to 1. So, after that, I've already got deck shuffled. You will draw 5 cards from your personal deck. And then overturn the top 6 cards for the center row deck. And again, you can put them straight out however you wish. Small desk, I gotta kind of conserve room. And then after that, you're pretty much ready to go. So on your turn, if you played other deck building games, this should go really smoothly, because it pretty much works the exact same way as Ascension, with one minor little difference, so to speak. And that is when it comes to actually dealing combat to players. Beyond that, though, everything works about the same way. So you'll start out by playing any cards you wish. And again, you might as well almost play them all unless something has an effect you don't want to use right away, because much like with other deck building games, the cards are use them or lose them for that turn. So in this case, putting up my 5 cards here, we have 4 gems I can use to spend all stuff in the center row and 1 power. So first thing you can do is, again, you can spend your gems to buy stuff out of the center row. And just kind of taking a look at what we got here. I don't want to spend all four yet, because there's going to be something important I need to talk about in just a moment. So let's see. I can go ahead and demonstrate how to do a fast play of a mercenary here. I can spend three of the gems. And I can go ahead and fast play Shard Abstractor to gain two mastery. I'm going to fast play it there, so my mastery automatically jumps up to two. Wrong way. There we go. I still have one gem left. Go ahead and replace that. And I could, if I wish, go ahead and acquire Wraith Skirmisher, but all characters also have an ability at the bottom that says Focus, which is the name of the ability, pay one gem and exhaust to gain one mastery. To exhaust means to pretty much turn sideways or tap, if you're familiar with collectible card games. So that's what we're going to go ahead and do. We're going to use the final gem to go ahead and tap Decima to gain that one mastery. And since you have to tap to do it, you can't do it more than once per turn. So now there is not much else that can be done. So Decima has one power, and the only thing really to do with it, because there's no champions on the board, is to attack Volos for one damage. Now, you might be thinking, well, it's going to be a very long time to knock someone down to zero. It's actually not. I'll get into that in a little bit when I get my final thoughts on things. But that's all Decima can do. So any cards that were used or any cards still left in your hand, go to your discard pile. You draw your new hand of five cards, and anything that was exhausted becomes unexhausted. Now, as per most deck building games, when you run out of cards in your deck and you are required to draw, shuffle your discard pile, and that becomes your new draw deck. It's important, though, to remember, do not shuffle your discard pile until you have to draw something, because there are cards that require you to have something in your discard pile, and you don't want to accidentally screw that up. So next over here for Volos, let's go through a real quick turn here. We have three crystals, a blaster, and a shard reactor. So the three crystals will give me three gems. The shard reactor gives me two. Mastery is only at one for Volos, so none of the other lines matter, and the blaster gives me one power. So five gems. I'm going to go ahead and actually take the Aether Breaker, but I'm not going to fast play it. So I put that to the side. I now have one gem left. So I'm going to go ahead and take that Wraith Skirmisher as well. Actually, I am. I'm going to go ahead and take the Wraith Skirmisher as well. And you saw me do a little hesitation there, and that was because I was thinking real quick if I wanted to spend the last gem to purchase something, or if I wanted to spend it to gain mastery. A lot of the cards in this game do work really well with their own faction. If you play games like Ascension or especially Star Realms, then the different factions will usually have different things that they work towards. Like for instance, in Star Realms, your four factions, one is like based on damage, one's based on getting health back, and so on. This is kind of the same way. And a lot of it goes towards what kind of strategy you're looking to get. So for instance, with Wraith here, the two cards I got, essentially, not only does one give me four, my mastery's not 10 yet, and the other gave me two, the Wraith Skirmisher also has the ability of Echo, which is gain six power instead if there's a Wraith card in your discard pile. So a lot of the times, it might be worth going after cards of the same faction, so they work together, and while getting the 30 mastery could instantly mean end of the game, it may not necessarily want to be your primary goal. Think of it as like a side goal, that if you want to work towards getting a high mastery, go for it. But it's not the only way to win the game. So with that, something I did forget to mention with the combat, because there were no champions in play. Before you do your final combat damage, as you're playing cards and you're taking care of those effects, go ahead and take care of champions then. Because once you're done with what I guess you'd call your main purchasing phase or acquiring phase, and you move on to dealing combat damage, the only thing left that you can do is to deal damage to your opponent. And again, if you have multiple opponents, if there are three or four people playing, you can deal that damage out to whoever you wish. And you can kind of just split it however you want. So, I would deal the 1 damage to Decima. Actually, it should be on 49. I didn't actually damage anything yet. I didn't realize it wasn't set. And that is going to be it for Volos. They draw their next 5 cards. And that is it. So, essentially, that's how a turn works. But there's one other little thing to talk about that would happen a little more towards probably mid-game. So, I'm going to get a little further along in this and then to briefly bring up the other concept, which is reducing damage in combat. So the other thing I need to talk about real quick is reducing damage in combat. Now you may have noticed something that I kind of got to mention on when I was talking about cards earlier, and that is some cards will have a shield next to it with a number. You can actually reveal those from your hand to reduce damage done to you. So, for instance, it is Volos' turn, and we're going to go ahead and place some cards here. We have 2 crystals, and now we're going to really turn things up a bit. We have Aether Breaker, which gives 4 power. Wreath Skirmisher, which gains 2. Echo does not go into play because there's not another Wreath card in the discard pile. And Ghost Willow Avenger, which does 4. So altogether, that would be 10 damage when we get to dealing combat damage. Before we get there, though, we're going to go ahead and we're even going to just fast play this Mercenary real quick for 2 to add on 2 more damage. So we're just kind of piling on the damage here. In fact, we're going to set this to the side since it was fast played. So it says I may banish a card in my hand or discard pile as well. With past games, or with other deck building games rather, banishing a card means you're taking it from the designated location and removing it from the game entirely. So again, it's a way to thin out your deck to get your more powerful cards quicker. But here we got 4, 8, 10, 12 points of combat damage. Everything is done for Volos. That's 12 combat going straight over the Decima. Well, Decima happens to have 2 cards in her hand with the shield icon. So, if you have cards in your hand with the shield icon and you have damage coming to you directly, not to your champions, just to you, you can reveal any number of cards in your hand with the shield icon and reduce the damage by that much. So, in this case, Decima has 2 Corvus Legionnaires that they're going to go ahead and reveal. Each one has a shield icon on it with a 2 inside it, which means it will reduce that 12 damage by 4, and so they would only take 8. So they would go from 47 down to 39. Now, when you reveal cards with the shield icon in that manner, you don't actually discard them. They actually go right back to your hand. Now, it doesn't mean you can just keep flashing the same card over and over and reducing the damage down to nothing, but that does also mean, though, that you can still play it during your turn. And, heck, if this is a multiple-person game, and someone was going between Volos and Decima, and that person decided to attack Decima again, they could reveal those exact same cards and reduce the damage by that much. And, yes, you can reduce the damage down to 0. So, that is how reducing damage would work. And, in a sense, that is it for how Shards of Infinity works. Now, again, the goal is to be the last person standing. If your life gets to 0, you're out. And that's why, if it's your primary goal, great. It might also want to be just a secondary goal, and that is getting your mastery to 30. Because again, once you get your mastery to 30, you have that really nice Infinity Shard card that gives you infinite power when your mastery is at 30. And since you can split damage amongst whoever you wish, and can deal damage to multiple people in one turn, that's why it's essentially game over if you have 30 mastery and draw the Infinity Shard. Because, well, you have infinite power, what are they going to do to you? But, essentially, that is Shards of Infinity. So, I'm going to clean here and we'll be back in just a moment with my overall thoughts on the game. So, overall, this is actually, to me, pretty enjoyable. The game box on the front does say it takes about 30 minutes, and I can attest to that. I took this to a friend's house the other day, introduced them to it because I introduced them to Ascension a while back. They really enjoyed that, so I figured this is incredibly similar, so let's see how they feel about that, and they both really enjoyed it as well. I've only played a few different deck building games. I've played Ascension, I've now played Shards of Infinity,
I played Star Realms, I played Dominion. I've attempted to play Resident Evil. That's loads of fun to try to figure out. And then I have Red Dragon in Battle for Greyport. I've yet to actually even play that. I've cracked it open, but I've yet to actually experience it. And I can definitely say that out of the ones I've played before this, Ascension is probably my favorite deck building game. This actually now might just ease into that a little bit, because this has more of a, Ascension is competitive, because you're all trying to get as much honor as possible, and the cards you purchase add toward that. Whereas with this, it's more competitive in that you're trying to take down your opponents. When me and my friends were playing, our first game, we decided that we were just going to we didn't decide to do this, it just happened, where we were splitting our damage evenly amongst everyone, trying to keep everyone kind of even leveled. But the ability to distribute the damage how you wish is very nice when it comes to if someone's getting a little too close in terms of like really high mastery, if you know they're getting really powerful cards, you might want to focus on them first. That way you don't quite feel as threatened with what they have, because once they're out of the game, their cards really don't matter anymore, and that does it. But overall, this is very enjoyable. Now, do I have really any complaints with it? Not really. More like minor nitpicks, and that is, it is only four people. Ascension, you could technically, I think Ascension technically is advertised to go up to four people. Though, with later expansions, you could actually go higher if you wish, because you can combine all the decks for Ascension, and you could, with each new major set, you get more sets of the starting cards. So you can essentially add on more. With this, I really hope, obviously I hope that this really takes off, though add more sets down the line. And if so, maybe like Ascension added new mechanics, like each major set in Ascension had a new mechanic to include. I hope they do the same with this, and then maybe even introduce like a multiplayer type thing with it. Technically, there are only four character cards, but since they all do the exact same thing, then you could probably, if they do release other sets, maybe take the starting cards from another set, mix the center deck cards together, and then have someone just use like dice or pencil and paper to keep track of life and mastery. But my only other real minor nitpick is the fact that each character has the exact same ability. Now, I know it might be hard to come up with abilities to kind of keep things a little more balanced, but it would be nice if other characters were introduced, or if they come out with more expansions or more sets, introduce characters that have different abilities. So that way it's not just like, well, I guess I'll take Volos, or I guess I'll take Tetra. But have a reason for picking a particular character, like, okay, well, that person can pay a gem and exhaust to gain one mastery. Maybe this character can pay two gems and exhaust to gain one or two power, something like that. And that way, kind of gives a little more urgency, maybe, I guess, to taking out certain characters first, because they might have a more threatening, I don't really know how to really put it to where it makes sense, or maybe even certain characters work better with their certain factions, because each of the characters are the different colors of the four factions. So maybe have each character maybe work better with certain factions. But beyond that, yes, this is definitely enjoyable. I would definitely say go ahead and pick this up if you are into deck building games, especially games like Ascension and Star Realms. Again, if you've played those two and you enjoy them, you'll probably enjoy Shards of Infinity, because it's more or less the same thing, and that's not necessarily a bad thing. So with that is all I've got for Shards of Infinity. I thank you all for watching, and I will see you next time whenever I put out another one of these videos.